traditionally speaking, for cultural diplomacy, you never spoke about human rights. That was sort of a taboo topic. The idea was to talk about nice things, easy things, jazz, art, design. But I think to a certain degree, what this morning regarding also environment change, etc., and human rights are for me two very important topics as to cultural diplomacy can go. It's one thing for us to present Moroccan culture and say this is nice, or to present American culture and say this is nice. It's another thing to get Moroccans and Americans to work together and talk about human rights, or to talk about climate change. That's the direction I think cultural diplomacy should be going in. How can you and I make a contribution to society? In the process of that, okay, I'll get to know your culture, you'll get to know my culture, we'll build trust, which is in essence, I think, what cultural diplomacy is about. But accomplish something greater, something more important than you and I and your culture and my culture, but we can actually make a contribution to the global society. And that's, for me, I think, a really important link when it comes to human rights and cultural diplomacy, or also issues such as the environment, climate change, and other global challenges that are all facing us. So what I'd like to do is maybe begin with a general introductory question for each of the speakers, just to get some reflections to bounce the discussion into its own life. And then as soon as we can, jump to you to take your questions, to take your comments. As I always say, God gave us two ears and one mouth for a reason. I think that the listening aspect is important. Like to listen to you to see which questions are really the most important questions to you, what topics let's debate. Hopefully we don't agree on everything, that would be boring. And in a respectful way, it'd be great just to exchange, debate, and analyze from a number of different points of view these very complex issues. And that's why I'm very grateful that we have such a diverse audience representing so many parts of the world, so many different fields. It should lead to a very interactive discussion. So why don't I begin maybe in gentleman style, ladies first, Madame Skalli. I will maybe start in English. If you can try to respond in English, would be great. Otherwise, French, of course, is fine, and I will try my best, maybe with our colleague from the embassy, to give you as good a translation as we can, just to make it accessible to everyone here who also doesn't know French. What I wanted to basically begin the discussion, the general question, where do you see the connection between human rights and cultural diplomacy, and what relevance does this cultural factor have? I mean, is human rights just about justice and the law, or diplomacy elements that might be relevant? And I'm noticing, Esteban, there seems to be the microphone. Should I maybe try the other microphone? I'm not sure if, is that the issue? Okay, so, all right, well, let's continue with this. In the meantime, if you can maybe find a solution, would be good. Otherwise, it's not a big room. We can also theoretically do it without. The microphone is important. As you all know, we're documenting the entire conference, so with video, et cetera, so we really do have some good documentation. So, Madame Skalli, where do you see the connection in human rights and cultural diplomacy, or what relevance does culture have in this broader discussion about human rights?
Thank you very much. Really, when I wanted to speak about climate justice and human rights, Mark asked me to don't forget that we have to speak about cultural diplomacy. So first, I would like to congratulate ICD and Mark for this important theme and important conference. And it was not easy for me to find the link between cultural diplomacy and climate change, because the conference of parties, the COP 22, that was about climate change, I had to look over all the COPs and to see where is the link with cultural diplomacy. And I find that in the beginning, in 1995, the first COP that was in Berlin, there was nobody was speaking about the role of culture in sensibilization about the dangers of climate change. And we had to wait until COP 9 in Copenhagen, it was the COP 14 that for the first time they see the importance of sharing this problem with the culture. And when I spoke about scientists that say, artists, we need you, because people, even when you speak in one international conference about climate change, and you speak and there is the state that take a decision and so on, if there is not the role of culture that make people really feel with their emotion, with their sensitive way to feel what is the danger of the climate change, you cannot be successful really in getting a popular adhesion about the topics and about the objectives that are the goals that are important, that are crucial to make a resistance to climate change. And even, for example, in our country, now, thanks to the role of the civil society, and I think that also the role of civil society is a part of cultural diplomacy. I think that cultural diplomacy is not only the culture and art, but it is also all the soft power, all the ways, except the role of the states and the official. It's the role of all the representatives of the population to make things be really popular. And I think that thanks to this sharing the problems with artists, with the civil society, it makes now this problem is everybody in Morocco feel the importance of conserving the environment. And in this area, I would like to say that in Morocco, we have had a national chart of sustainable development, environment, and sustainable development that have been prepared by a way, participative way since 2010. And the fact that there was a big fora in all the region of Morocco with elected people, but also with civil society, with artists, with academia, with the private sector, it makes everybody thinks about the consequences, thinks about what we have to preserve and what we must do to preserve our environment, because without our environment, there is no earth, but also there is no humanity. Perhaps they say that human is going to disappear, but earth is going to stay here. And it's our, together we are obliged to, I don't use the just word, but I use the word that I find in my in English. So we are all obliged to share the sensibilization, and it cannot be without the participation of we have the singers that have make a lot of songs in the area of preserving environment. There is also the painters, the artists that have make a big exhibition in COP22. There is also some films. There is a lot of initiatives that make it closer to the people. And also there is a lot of innovative initiatives from young people, from associations that make things different. As example, I give, I cannot say it in English, a refrigerator.
Refrigerator.
A refrigerator without energy, without power. For the countryside, they took only, they took the traditional way that was, il y avait des pots de terre. I don't. That make things be cold, and with that, young engineers have innovated a kind of place where you can put fruits and legumes, and they stay more than 10 days without, and it is very cheap. It is without power, and it is very cheap. And it is one of the examples, but there is a lot of examples. And I think that if the world was using such a way to involve people, like using culture, sharing with the artists, speaking not only with our head, but also with our emotion, with our feeling as human being, as solidarity, as what we would like to be done for the dignity of all the population, I think that the things would be much better. And sharing a new last word to say, making men and women together to make policies. It's not just to have only men that decided for the future of the humanity, because the future of humanity can't be only by the heads of men. It should be from the heads of men, both men and women, because we share the world, we must share the power, and we have equal responsibility in the future of the humanity. Thank you very much.
No, thank you very much for those excellent reflections. You can keep that, we can share. Yeah, I want to just maybe reflect on a few things you mentioned. There was a lot of really important points that you made. First of all, what struck me is the point you made, most scientists are not worried about the Earth. In that sense, the Earth will go on, like it always has. There'll be an ice age, it'll clean itself. The Earth will find a solution if we continue to burn it and do everything that we're doing. The question is humanity, and that's, of course, the link to human rights. Do my three children have a human right also to have a world to live in? Do they need to wear masks when they enter Los Angeles because of smog? Is it their right to be able to build a snowman in Germany, you know, that we have cold winters, that doesn't just keep warming? You know, those things, I think definitely there's a connection there. And of course, culture in that sense is very relevant. And if you just compare, I think Morocco and Germany maybe have a lot in common when it comes to the environment. I think both countries in many ways are really pioneers at a number of levels when it comes to environment. And we have to ask also the cultural question, how lifestyles, how sustainable are our cultures? The idea of wearing a suit and a tie and pants and all of this and cufflinks and going into an air-conditioned car and driving to work and going to an air-conditioned office and this and that. And if you think of the cities, I will try to slow down. But if you think of the lifestyles of most of our urban cities, is this really sustainable? Is this really necessary? Does it really help us? The one high-level conference we cooperated with in Morocco was together with your Minister of Tourism, who's actually a member of our board, and it took place in Dakhla, a beautiful part of Morocco near the water, actually in the water, an island. And what was fascinating, for the first time I stayed in a 5-star hotel that was consisting of tents, not of buildings. We were all kind of shocked. We came with the bus, you know, from the airport, heads of state, former heads of state, some people also who are with us this conference, and it was really beautiful. It was great. So it was a very simple tent. We each of us bathroom in their shower, etc. And we got up in the morning, left our tent, we walked to the conference area, since it was right next to it, no need for cars, no need for anything. Solar power was one of the main sources of energy there. And it was just an interesting example. I don't think the intention was to make this necessarily a climate conference. We were talking about other issues, but just small things like that in our lifestyles can definitely make a difference. Or my wife is actually Tunisian in background, going through the streets in Tunisia. You actually, it's a beautiful country, I love it in so many ways, but you see there's no really sustainable system of dealing with that. You're on the beach, the people will drink their plastic bottle of water and just throw it. I would sort of cringe, you know, every time. Go to a country like Rwanda, where actually plastic bags are illegal, and you see how important a policy like that can be. I said, why would they make plastic bags illegal? But it was exactly because of that issue, and it's one of the cleanest African countries as a result. Also, speaking of gender equality, Rwanda, I think, is maybe one of the leaders, if not the leader, when it comes to female participation in politics. There's more members of the parliament who are women in Rwanda than men, for many reasons, also historical. So I think culture definitely does play an impact comes to climate change, human rights, etc. The final point I wanted to make linked to cultural diplomacy, what you were describing in your speech and reflecting on here, I would consider amongst the students in our classroom what I call indirect cultural diplomacy. In the past, cultural diplomacy was more direct. I want to tell you about my culture, I want to tell you about my music, I want to tell you about my movies. Indirect culture is when you and I come together and we focus on something else, such as climate change, such as human rights and the environment, and definitely, as I was saying earlier, that's the way I think we can move forward. Cultural diplomacy can feed two birds with one seed, so to speak. We're going to build understanding and trust in the process of talking about human rights, like I think we're doing this week. But in the process, we also will make contributions to something greater. So therefore, I thought that was a great way to begin the panel. Maybe let's turn to Professor Jalali, who is a professor, who is a diplomat, who has had so many experiences. I think you've seen this from a number of angles. Where do you see the connection between human rights and this cultural factor, so to speak? Or how could cultural diplomacy maybe contribute to the broader human rights discourse? And in the end, of course, most important when it comes to human rights is not talk, but action. You know, how can we somehow get this to the implementation where we really can allow certain human beings to breathe easier because of the work that we're doing?
much. Yes, you know, there are soft issues that you can talk forever about them, about culture diplomacy, and as far as it's related to the human rights issues. But there are very hardcore issues, too, particularly in underdeveloped societies or developing societies, where you have the tribal societies, you have customary justice system, and where you have the lack of institutional coverage everywhere in the country. For example, I would say in Afghanistan, customary justice is something get very different from the formal justice in Afghanistan. People in areas like tribal areas and some other parts, they have their own justice system, which actually is violating many issues of human rights, particularly against women, children, the marriage issues, and also resolving conflict resolution issues. That is the, although the formal justice and customary justice system coexisted for centuries in Afghanistan and some other tribal areas in that region, including some parts of Central Asia, even when Central Asia was dominated by the Soviet Union. So in those countries, the peripheries, the tribal areas, they are governed by the traditional justice system. Although the formal system is there, but when you are to do a conflict resolution process, then you have to refer to both customary justice and formal justice. I have my own first-hand experience with it. When I finished my education and came from abroad, the first task that I had to do was to resolve a dispute between two tribes in Paktia. Paktia is a province in the southeast of Afghanistan. They were fighting over the rights of logging. It was living that side of the mountain, the other side of the mountain. So that was, they were the logging. They had their own traditional system that they divide the tribes into smaller groups and families, and then they decide. However, this violates the human rights of individuals. So I went there as part of a delegation, and the government has courts the system there. So we had to first resolve it through just the system, and then go and officialize it to the court system. And then it took a long time. Many years, I think the government tried to use the education and also programs for understanding to change it. But it works only when you have communication, we have control over these areas. When you do not have control over these areas, they will go back to the system, which, as I said, they violate the human rights of many people. The bride price, for example, is something that, although on the books, the law prevents people to do it, but unless you have a control over the area, then they will do it. The only thing that they can do with that is persuasion. Persuasion, that is where cultural diplomacy actually make a major difference in improving human rights in those areas. I can see this very clearly from my own experience. But on the other hand, as I said earlier, the legitimacy of a state depends on two major pillars. One is security, protection of the population. The other one is justice, which is the rule of law in any system. In order for any government to exercise that two things, it has to have control over its territory, which at the same time is a condition for sovereignty in international law. So here, you look at the cultural diplomacy in the context of human rights in these situations. Of course, in other countries, it is different. Even go to very civilized countries, very industrialized countries, very advanced countries. Understanding of people, the culture changes for a while. You have the law in the United States, the civil rights movement that in the 1960s. But still today, culturally, there are certain things that you cannot see it happening automatically. Here, you need cultural diplomacy, even in very advanced countries like the United States and other countries in Europe. And with the movement of population in the areas, I think the clash of culture becomes a major, major issue. That's because of lack of understanding. We fear people. Why? Because we don't understand them. We don't know them. We don't know them because you do not have contact with them. Once you contact with people, and then you understand them, you feel them, what do you think, and what do you think? And feel that you don't fear them. Then you don't fear them, then you exchange culture. Here is another issue of cultural diplomacy is a larger context that affects directly human rights. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. And that's exactly the balance, as you were saying, between the local and the global. And also this question, how do we deal with each other? There was a politically correct movement in the USA not too long ago where there was the idea, okay, I respect you, you respect me, whatever you do is okay. Is okay, which is of course the one extreme where we just tolerate or we accept everything. That's of course not possible, and I think that we wouldn't accept. There are many very serious violations taking place in our own countries and other countries, so that doesn't work. On the other hand, I think it's also false to think that there's sort of this universal human rights that 100% applies all around the world either. On some of the basic issues, okay, genocide in 1951, the world agreed, okay, this is a crime, we have to intervene. We still didn't intervene in many cases, and we were too late in many cases, but that for me is an easy issue, so to speak, in the sense, okay, I think we all agree. The problem is, what about those other, as you said, more local issues, more trickier issues, where it's more of a shade of gray and it's not necessarily black or white, and there's no easy answer. Maybe that's part of the work of cultural diplomacy, to balancing, to have that conversation and to try to find the balance. How do we respect individuals? How do we, embrace the cultures that they have while also somehow trying to find the balance where justice is important, where human rights are important, and civil rights? A very difficult thing to do. Mr. Ali, I would be very, very happy if you would also give us some of your reflections on the connection of cultural diplomacy and also human rights and the cultural aspect of human rights.
Thank you. First of all, I think we should all ask ourselves some questions. What is the culture? This one you will answer, because culture is not the same. Culture differ from tribe to tribe. Some cultures acceptable. It's actually, culture is an acceptable behavior of community. And therefore, community A's culture is not superior in any way to another. And culture is also pragmatic. It changes with the society. He says they've been to culture, to Rwanda, and they found different behavior there. That is adaptable. This culture wasn't there, but it is it's acceptable culture. Now, when you are in Rwanda, you drop a small piece of paper. This is illegal. Somebody will come and pick it for you, but it's not acceptable. So culture is the acceptable behavior of individual group of people anywhere in the world. And it is the pragmatic. It changes from day to day, from time to time. And it's not superior to any other culture. Culture is, if once the society accepted it, that's it. The other culture also different. What is the human rights? Human rights are those inalienable rights, right born by somebody, the right given by God. Somebody has right for life. This is a human right. You don't take somebody's life because this is given to God, by God. And human rights is the freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of... That is the human rights, which should not be violated. But at the same time, there is a system, government system. All of us have come from governments. And wherever government we left behind has a system, has a constitution that guides the country with the people and how the government should look after her people. And these constitutions in Uganda, for example, all Ugandans are born innocent before the court of law. If you accuse me of abusing you or of stealing something, I'm innocent until I'm proved guilty, until I accept myself that, I'm sorry, I've done it. Unless these two things happen, I'm innocent. Then with this system in the constitution and many things happen in the country, the same constitution has charged the country or government with responsibility to maintain law and order. And there is a police force, there is the army, there is a prison. Who are going to prison? It's not animals, it's us. How do you go to prison? Why do you go to prison? Is now government to enforce the responsibility given to it by the constitution. And now the constitution says maintain law and order. If you steal somebody's thing, you must be arrested. So police must arrest you. So in the process here, there is a human rights, which is also mixing up, that there must be freedom of speech. But no human rights condition, I said, there must be freedom of theft. You are not allowed to steal. So when government is trying to maintain law and order among the people, then the constitution is being broken. When you have stolen something, and then government arrests you, the constitution says you are innocent until you are proved guilty, until you accept. Or if you don't, you cannot even give evidence. You can keep quiet in our system. I don't know what others. If in Uganda, if I don't want to say anything, I can keep quiet. I can't even not defend myself. It is up to the prosecutor to prove me guilty. It's a very difficult task. Then, this recent occasion, there is a new introduction which is called terrorism. In Uganda, you cannot keep me in the police for 48 hours. If you cannot take me to court within 48 hours, then I must be acquitted. I must be released. But when you come across a terrorist, somebody who is claimed to be terrorist, this 48 hours does not apply. Then a different system must come. So where does the human rights apply? What stage? And if you say there is a freedom of this, freedom of this, freedom of anything is freedom of independence is relative. Freedom of speech is relative. Because it's not only your freedom also applies to my freedom and applies to anybody's freedom. And if you step on my freedom, is no longer your freedom. You have also my freedom. So which is which? When shall we say, because of freedom of religion? In Uganda, actually, we have in the constitution, there is no state religion. We are free. Whatever religion you want, you practice. So long as it does not offend somebody. There are some people in Uganda, because of this freedom, at night they are drumming, shouting, even after midnight. They are already affecting people because interfering with the people's sleep. So people go to police. What is happening? The police commander will come and say, stop it. Stop it now. Because they have gone beyond freedom of religion. It's no longer freedom of religion. Because you're affecting other people's well-being, sleeping, and many others. Therefore, in my speech, I've read many countries are torturing people. Many countries are releasing people. The refugees are being released to go to their countries. Our brother professor said 50 Afghanis are on their way to Afghanistan as the refugees. Are these released properly? Or they are forced to go back and so on? I don't know. However, all this is conflict of law. Government says law is broken. Somebody here says he does not break the law. But if you are a refugee, you have come. Now I've run out of my life for safety, for my life. Then you here as a government say, no, you're just an economic refugee. Go back. That is a conflict of interest, conflict of law. Who finally decides? Where will this refugee go to appeal against this decision? So what I'm saying, actually, there are three things. One, there is culture. Two, there is the human rights. Three, there is law and order. Four, there is a government with the constitution in his hand. They say government is a man. His or her hand, I don't know. Therefore, cultural diplomacy is now brought us in to dialogue between the government and the people, and even the lawbreakers. Possible terrorist people, how do you talk to the terrorist? Who has come or is come can even blow us up here? How do you know this type of people? They can come here and doesn't fear to die, he puts on the jacket, something blows all of us out. How do you type of people? This is to me a long a tall, tall order. Cultural diplomacy is very, very important. It involves all of us. It needs serious discussion. It needs even the religious people should really reinterpret their religion properly. Because religious, according to, I'm a Muslim, but in our prophet's time, there were no Sunni or Shia. A Muslim will understand what I'm talking about. But now, this is being used to fight. This is being used to fight, to kill people, innocent people. And there was nothing like this during our prophet's time. Our religion is very simple. No force. You can't force somebody to become a Muslim. No, there is no and you don't kill people. So what is this new phenomenon? Who is bringing these new ideas? And now Muslims are now related to terrorism. If you are a Muslim, you are a terrorist, potential terrorist. It's not all terrorists. And even those who are terrorists are not actually true Muslims. So I want to rest my case. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think Ms. Skalli wanted to also make a comment. And we're technically out of time, although Ms. Skalli wanted to give a comment, and then I want to take at least a few questions from all of you that maybe we can reflect on over lunch, since we didn't have a proper chance for discussion. But first, Madam Skalli.
Thank you very much. Just I would like to say one word about the title of the conference, ICD conference. It's important to take all the words of the title, promoting global human rights through cultural diplomacy. And the word global, for me, is very important because it is all the human rights, the first generation of human rights, civil and politic, second generation of human rights, that is economical, social, and cultural rights, and the third generation, that is environmental rights. But also, for me, global means human rights for everybody. And it is not evident to say that human rights is not only in general, but it is for men, for women, for children. And there is a lot of issues that is specific, I can say, to women. And when we speak about culture, and we, of course, are obliged to respect all the cultures of all the people. But there is some things, some practice that are from the culture, but are some traditions are very positive, and we have to improve them. But some tradition and culture are very negative. And you can say, as example, early marriage for children. Some people said, in our culture, girls must marry at 14, at 15, at 16. And it is against human rights. You cannot say, nobody can say that our culture told us to marry young girls. Also, violence against women. Violence against women, I would like to say some things about that, because there was some problem, for example, in Europe, by young people from some countries of the North Africa about sexual harassment toward girls. I know that it is a problem that was very dérangeant, it was very embarrassing. But I would like to say that it is also culture. Culture that said in our countries that the women must take care of herself, but man is free. He is free to speak with girl. He's free to, if a girl is with des habits, with the mini or something like that, he feels free to speak with her and perhaps to go more with her. So it's a problem of culture, and I think that it is very important if we want to have the heart in to share the world and to have to live mondialization. We have to have same references for human rights. We cannot say that culture authorize me to have such a relationship with women, that culture told me that I can oblige women to make veil on her head, and there is nothing in the religion that obliged women to make a veil. But the culture, the new culture, said, no, if you are Muslim, you are obliged to make the veil. And also, I think for democratic countries, they cannot sometimes they want to respect the culture, and they leave this problem. I said, for example, in Canada, there was a tentative to make, they say, yes, you have justice of Canada, but as community of Muslims, we would like to have our own court, to have our own, intervention of our religious people to solve problems. But it's not innocent, because we cannot say, yes, we are going to our culture to make the women's rights not respected. And I said that there is other problems like death penalty that is not in the Quran. But some religious people said, ah, no, 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 we cannot abolish death penalty because it's a religious consideration. Also for slavery, for some peoples, they have in their tradition, they have slavery, but it is not acceptable that we say, yes, I don't want to say some countries, but in Mauritania or in other countries, they said we have tradition of slavery. You cannot say, yes. So I think that it is important to say always global human rights for everybody and to speak about everybody, and also to say that culture cannot be against human rights. Human rights must be universal. And what is not human rights, universal human rights, can be respect, of course, of the culture, with taking what is positive and with leaving what is against human rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We're actually out of time right now, so if it's okay, I want to jump in and be a dictator in terms of how I think we can do this. I want to delegate Professor Jalali, if he agrees, to give the concluding remarks. However, before that, I do want to take some questions and comments, and I think there obviously we can't have too much back and forth, just because otherwise they'll be angry at the restaurant downstairs, but let's take maybe a handful of questions or comments. I'd ask everyone, please keep them brief, so we can hear as many voices as possible. And I'll give it to Professor Jalali to reflect, if you would like, on some of those comments, concluding remarks, and then the proper discussion we'll have to do over the lunch break. I think you were first to raise your hand, and then we'll continue to the back. And please introduce yourselves as well, so we know.
My name is Professor Rod Heiferman. I'm here with my wife, Dr. Judith Miller, as a private citizen from the United States. I've heard in the last 2 days a good deal of human garbage, the human remains of wars that were based on religion. So that, yes, your religious belief or your lack of belief may impact your culture, but in fact, unless we separate God from human rights, there will never be universal human rights. That's the end of my sermon.
Thank you very much. Maybe you could pass the microphone back, and we'll continue. Just take as many comments as possible.
Hello, my name is Linda. I'm a student at the ICD, taking a master's in international economics. And the global human rights, of course, transcends from the UN Convention on the Rights of the Human Person, formulated by, of course, the UN and other moral authorities such as the EU and the US. Where we get our moral interpretations. And Professor Jalali rightfully commented that this human rights are interpreted differently depending on culture and society and other. And I'm just wondering, in your opinion, Professor Jalali, do you think developed countries, this moral authorities, the UN, the countries of the EU, the US, are they taking greater efforts to understand the different cultural aspects of developing countries in the interpretation of human rights, or what do you think is the general trend lately?
Excellent. Raise your hands again. Let's move the microphone to the other side, step by step.
Good morning. My name is Nyanya. I'm from Senegal, and I'm a cultural promoter as work in Senegal as an entrepreneur, but as well communications and event manager. And I think that the cultural aspect, maybe we're taking it on the wrong way, because like in math, the culture is a definition domains of the equation we're trying to solve right now. It means like in Senegal, for example, when we have some questions, homosexuality or wherever, the first answer you hear is it's not in our culture. So I think at a certain point also, human rights must be followed or must follow human responsibilities at a certain point. As a human being, what are my responsibilities in this world to my neighbor and on a global level? And then from there, whether I understand the other or don't agree with him, I have to respect. It joined the idea of trust that cultural diplomacy is advocating for, and from responsibilities as human being and respect to the others, maybe it will be better for people, because at a certain point it's not only about government and politicians, it's also for people on the ground to understand concepts and appropriate them. It's not just about popularity. And I, for example, Honorable Skalli, Morocco, I know, is one of the success model in Africa right now in terms of sustainable development, art and culture promotions, but it's also a perfect example of all the contradictions. So you were talking earlier about how art and culture are being used right now to advocate on essential issues, but how come, for example, that an actress which happened to play a role in a movie, Maroc, in gender equality in a country where you are working and trying to tackle gender inequality, had to be nearly in the need to run away to feel safe? I think at a certain point, maybe cultural diplomacy is not just that thing that we have to integrate, but it has to be the core at a certain level. So I would definitely like to hear your answer as a woman, Muslim and Moroccan, living in a Maghreb country where I've been living last year in Morocco, and I saw a lot of issues which I could relate personally. Thank you.
Let's continue and try to get as many voices as we can. If everyone, again, please keep your comments concise, and then we can hear as many as possible.
My name's Gamboya Kubo Jibrin, student of ICD from Nigeria. It baffles me when you said you are propagating human rights. Why propagating human rights? Who infringes over the rights of others? Why are we advocating for human rights? The second question, are we really advocating for human rights? If the developed nations are advocating for human rights and they turn around to sell small arms to the developing nations to be fighting themselves, are we advocating human rights? The third question, how does culture, comes to link with terrorism? Why is terrorism? Who is terrorizing who? I am of the belief as a Muslim that there is no version in the Quran or Hadith that says someone should be a terrorist. And in most cases, the terrorists you find fighting, more especially today in Syria, in Libya, South Sudan, and the Boko Haram in Nigeria, they are not Muslims, most of them. Some cannot even recite Quran. So how does he become a Muslim? And why should a Muslim be tagged a terrorist if such things is happening? And to my understanding, what is happening today in Syria is a fight between power nations. They are not promoting or propagating human rights in those areas, because I am to understand that they are there to tap the raw materials or raw resources that those countries has to develop their own nations than developing the developing nations. So where is the human rights? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think we have time for maybe one or two more before Rosie starts jumping downstairs. So let's try to do it. And of course, the big discussion for these big questions will have to be during lunch, but let's get a few more in.
Thank you. I'm Tatiana. I'm artist and I work for the Lower Austrian government as consultant for intercultural education. and teacher trainings. I'm a part of the ICD since 2009. My question will be regarding policies and strategies in your countries for the cultural diplomacy. This year in January, European Commission and Goethe Institute signed a document, and cultural diplomacy for European Union has been officially announced platform. And in June this year, they also introduced the strategy for cultural diplomacy of the European Union, which is based on development of trust and mutual understanding among nations, and basically to protect peace, rule of law, freedom of speech, and to build on universal rights protection in global and wider context. So what Mark previously mentioned, a cultural diplomacy we practice and promote here in Berlin at the Institute for Cultural Diplomacy is not only based on promotion of attractions, which are just persuading people. It has more issues within common frame of interest, which are in global context, such as climate change. So the art has a significant and relevant message here and contribution, which is completely related to the common issues and values. So my question is there in your country any such strategy or policy or plan to implement cultural diplomacy as a significant factor and platform for international relations? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, one or two more. Try to keep them brief, and then I think we'll have to conclude.
Most conflict resolution processes fail because human rights are jeopardized. When a conflict is identified, there should be an emergency meeting right at the outset, and to be run by experts, impartial people who are able to resolve the problem. But on top of that, you need to involve political leaders, powerful interests, and the ordinary people. And the ordinary people are never represented in conflict resolution. Reason is, this peace is about ordinary people. But they are not represented. During this reconciliation or resolution, conflict resolution process, when the people are involved, then you will find that reconciliation and also trying to overlook the previous animosities will be achieved. So my question is, why are ordinary people not involved in conflict resolution, and when veto is allowed to overlook the resolution process?
Thank you. In the spirit of gender equality, there were two girls who have been patiently waiting the whole time. Let's maybe take those two as the last two comments. And then unfortunately, we are very over time.
Hello, my name is Jagriti. I'm a... Sorry. My name is Jagriti. I'm a master's student at the ICD. First of all, I would like to know from the panel that is there a difference between culture and religion? Because coming from India, we have so many religions, but our culture is not defined only by a religion. And secondly, my question is, do you think that human rights are a set of universal norms, not global, but universal norms, which are interpreted by different cultures differently? Or should culture be allowed to form human rights in parity with their culture? Thank you.
Final question? Well, in the spirit of human rights and not starting conflicts, let's take both. I don't want to be accused of any violations here myself. So ladies first, and then the final question.
Thank please. You, Mark. My name is Yara Mualla. I'm from Syria, and I'm a PhD student at the ICD in collaboration with the University of West of Scotland. Actually, I don't know if I'm having a question, but I'm going to throw three things fast. The first thing is, when I read the title, Global Human Rights, the Cultural Aspect, I was really concerned because for me, when we talk about culture, we talk about diversity, and the word global is such a big a word that give me this feeling that it's a top-down approach, and if we're talking human rights, it should be the opposite way around, and it should be coming after understanding the diversity of the universe. And I think that's like a huge work that is not happened, and it's human rights emphasized and imposed somehow from the concepts of the Western culture. And not saying that I don't agree with that, but in a way, I think it's a bit scary for me, the way it is, and how people will perceive that. And if we talk about cultural diplomacy and soft power, I think this is really hard power in imposing, in applying something that should be very human and great. So it doesn't work this way. The other part is the cultural diversity, and by that I don't mean when we check these meetings at the United Nations and we see that the Africans are wearing their costumes and the others are wearing things, or whenever they go to lunch you see this word halal on meat. This layer, I mean, that was really great before the internet, before all the knowledge that we know now about each other's nation to nation. I think we should have, I'm talking here on the higher level policies, we should really look at something deeper of this cultural diversity, understanding it in a deeper level. Now, talking about human rights as human rights, I think there is no culture that didn't think of human rights, meanwhile progressing in its life and in its development as a nation. The only problem that, which culture are we talking about, and which culture has been emphasized on media, and even sometimes within the same nation. And that's a big problem. I'm an Arab, and I'm exposed to the media, let's say the Arab media. And the only options I have is either the NBC channels, which are like talking only about singers and people dancing, and I'm not talking about a good art, I'm talking about really sometimes not even reflecting what is the Arab culture is somehow. Or there is this channel called Ikra, which means read, but it is only Quran, and that's it. And if I am an Arab young person, I have no other possibility to understand my culture, my own culture. There is no platform to figure out what's going on. If I go to the museum, I find it very old in the way it is, so I am not connected to it. And I am only bridged into these two ways. And these two ways have nothing to do with culture. So how can I lately understand the human rights? And so what I wanted to say is, culture is really something that can't be selective and can't be stereotyped. And if we stop looking at that and look on a deeper level, then I think we can really see the possibility where everybody will understand and proceed with the human rights on a better way, because it is embedded. But unfortunately, our generation is lost because we just don't have good access to our culture itself. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the contributions. Last comment, please be brief though, we're very over time.
Thank you so much. Zaland from Kabul Bakhtar University, Dean Faculty of Law. Thank you so much for ICD for providing this venue of discussion, very important topics. For me, culture and human rights, I think two different aspects. I have human rights as individual rights to live. But culture is not individual approach to living, it's a social, a society, a nation, how they decide. So when we are talking about culture, there are the division within countries in the globe. US, Germany, Afghanistan, Saudi Arabia, they have different geography and different boundaries. So we must respect the cultures also in the same as we are respecting the boundaries. The conflict comes because we do not think of those boundaries within the cultures. The way we live, we decide on the values that we live, and then we decide the devaluing the living values or the cultures of the other societies, and then we invade or we create oppositions and we go to a conflict. When we are undermining living within a society, the values that they have, the culture they have, we are creating conflicts. There is a very famous Pashto saying, Mr. Jalali would know that, that you can live, you can leave a society, but you cannot cross the castes within the society. So you leave, that's your decision to leave a society or a country or a culture, but you cannot play with the values within the culture. Regarding the terrorism and Islam, I think Islam is more than 1400 years there, but terrorism has come only 2001 when there was 9/11, then terrorism has come. So we cannot talk about Islam and terrorism together. If you are talking about terrorism, World War I, World War II, all those big wars, everything happening here in Europe, there wasn't any Islamic discussion to that. There wasn't any Islamic aspect to that. But there were countries that they are now talking about global human rights, talking about cultural aspects, many other values which they devalued in those wars, and they have created terrorism in the world. And now they are somehow blaming Islam or Islamic culture or Islams or Muslims and stereotyping them with the values that they have themselves created for world order. So we must be very much, I think, careful to discuss when we are talking about religion, we are talking about culture, and we are talking about global terrorism aspects. Thanks.
Thank you very much for that. Professor Jalali, your mission, if you choose to accept it, is to give some brief concluding remarks. Of course, there was a lot of questions there. Ideally, 1 or 2 minutes, just sort of a way for you to reflect on what was said here and also there. And then we do need to actually start making our way downstairs. So, Professor Jalali, the floor is yours.
Well, tough challenge. Let me, most of these were comments, which you respect, so I'll pick only two of these. One was the human rights and culture. Human rights is universal, that's what said everybody. So it does not mean that it applies to some people and does not apply to some other, including cultures. And the once a country actually become a signatory of that, it's obliged to observe human rights. It is not that human rights should adjust itself to them to cultures. Cultures should adjust themselves to the universal human rights. That is the challenge for the states to do that. Then, but practically, politically, you see that sometimes some human rights was taken as an excuse for criticizing some countries. Another stances that countries who were abusing human rights very violently, they were just an ally. So these are political things. It does not undermine the importance of human rights as being a universal rights for everybody. Culture has actually become a problem when it's politicized. Otherwise, culture is diversified. I see diversification in myself. Culture is a kind of onion. So many layers. Maybe I see 100 layers in myself. I was born as a Pashtun in Ghazni, a province of Afghanistan. One of the four branches of Pashtun. I'm one of these branches. So I do not identify with three other branches. It's Pashtun. Then in Pashtun, I'm under, in Ghilzai under. This under is one clan of many Ghilzais, so I am not identified with other Ghilzais. Then in under, I am living in one district which is different from other districts there. Then I became urban, so I grew up in an urban system, so I am very different from my villages. Then I am a Muslim, but I am Sunni Muslim, I am different from other Sunni Muslims, including sects of Sunnis and Shias. Then I am secular, so I am different from the people of my religion. Then I went to education to the West, so I am different from those who went there. I am different from my son, who is next generation. So there are so many things in this culture that I can identify myself in 100 ways. But it becomes an issue when you politicize it. or when there's a competition, economic, political, and other, you actually then actually make it an issue. Otherwise, it's not an issue. Every one of you, every one of us, in many cases, I'm culturally more closer to Mark than I'm closer to somebody in my village and all. So it is. Now, don't say that it is a culture, it's something that will be there and it is a solid thing. It changes over time. So it is not the universal human rights to adjust itself to culture. Culture should adjust themselves to the universal human rights. Thank you.
Thank you very much. A big applause for all of the panelists, please. Excellent discussion.